So the last point which was raised by Dr. Paul was about governance mechanisms, the health authority which has been created, and how the governance mechanism will be ensuring that the implementation of this initiative is properly done. And continuing that conversation on governance, I would like to invite Dr. Bharat Gadvi. He is the Chief Medical Officer and CMD of HCG Hospitals, and he will talk about governance in clinical setup. And I would request Priya to introduce Dr. Gadvi.
Thank you, sir. The next session is by Dr. Bharat Gadvi. He is the CEO and Medical Director of HCG Hospitals, Ahmedabad. He has over 13 years of experience in the field of hospital management and administration and has been instrumental in innovating healthcare management processes. He is also a member of CII's Subcommittee on Healthcare in the Western Region and was nominated by Divya Bhaskar Group as one of the Power 100 persons of the state of Gujarat for the year 2010 and 11. It's a pleasure to have you here, sir. Thank you.
Thank you for the generous introduction. Morning, everybody. We are all meeting in a gloomy environment when we have witnessed the martyrdom of our 40 of the CRPF personnel. I'm sure all of you have observed 2 minutes silence before the starting of the conference. And just because I listened to the Niti Aayog personnel, one of the key areas where our own jawans are still neglected in the healthcare sector, that is ECHS, is still not well organized, and a lot of hospitals are not empaneled, or they are not interested in empaneling. So maybe somebody should represent to Niti Aayog that either they are covered in the Ayushman Bharat or some better scheme. So that is when we are planning to cover almost 40 crore people in Ayushman Bharat, we should not be forgetting the people who actually guard us, who defend us. So before starting, I would like to say that clinical governance is still a very new thing in India. A lot of hospitals still do not have that vertical or a stream in the management. And it was way back in the early days when the healthcare was growing. It was usually a single doctor setup, and then multi-specialty setups came. When they came, companies usually provided the infrastructure, and this very important aspect that doctors have to be involved in the healthcare scenario was neglected. And the reason was purely they were all profit centers, or some of the hospitals were brought in by the trust, where they felt that care is more important than the other aspects, specifically the clinical outcomes, etc. So thank you, Rajesh, for inviting me here. So the hospitals, when they started, they felt that the internal customers or the external customers altogether were only the patients, their relatives, and the staff. And this important internal customer, the doctors, were forgotten. And that's why there was a huge gap between the requirements of the organization and the requirements of the doctors. Usually they were at loggerheads because the organizations wanted to ensure that the healthcare delivery costs are minimized, and the doctors wanted to ensure that the quality is not suffered. So that is where the issues happened, and the model, the clinical governance model, was brought in. That was way back in the late 1990s, where this term was coined, clinical governance, and the need of involving the doctors in the management of the hospitals was felt, and a structure was made. You can define clinical governance as a framework through which the hospitals and healthcare organizations are accountable for continuously improving the quality of their services and safeguarding the high standards of care that is required by creating an environment in which excellence in clinical care will flourish. So that is what the clinical governance is all about. This was mainly NHS's idea, where they coined the term and then they made the framework. I'll come to how the organization structure was changed from a straightaway governing body to a CEO and then management. So there was some change, we'll come to that. As I said, this was resulted because of the imbalance between the management and the clinicians. Clinicians wanted the best of the things because they wanted to ensure that the clinical outcome is the priority. Management wanted that, though of course their concern was healthcare delivery, but that was, the quality was never a priority for them. Their concern was that the healthcare services provided are provided at the minimal cost, considering the cost aspect at all levels. And this resulted into failure in delivering of quality healthcare services. So this imbalance resulted into a new structure wherein the clinicians were also involved in some aspects of the healthcare management. I already talked to you about the definition. The systematic joining up of all the patient safety and quality improvement initiatives, embedding those things in the hospital or healthcare management, that is what is clinical governance. So it is not only about the fiscal discipline or the top line or or the EBITDA, but it is also important that we do not forget the very important aspect of patient safety and quality. And this is a forum through which we are bridging the gap between the clinical leadership and the management leadership in terms of provision of healthcare services. This requires, to some extent, training of the clinicians in the important aspects of healthcare management, which is a tough thing. Most of the doctors do not enjoy coming into the management. Still, I am seeing that there is a huge lack of people who can lead clinical services, specifically those who have been into clinical practice or have been instrumental in the clinical services provision. These are the various areas where the clinical governance gets involved. So if you look at, there are four aspects. How it is done, like it is the consumers, that is where the patient experience and service come. Advanced care planning, the plan of care which is defined by the clinicians, and that has to match with the goals of the healthcare organization. And an open communication, like the informed consent, informing the patient about the choices of the management of that particular illness, whether it is like, is it necessary to do only surgery or there are other alternatives? And if there are alternatives, what are those alternatives? Whether they'll be costly, whether they'll be cheaper, whether it will help in achieving the same goal or the same outcome. All this has to be discussed with the patient. So an open communication approach with the patients and relatives. And a formation of a consumer council or involving the patient representatives in your governing boards. So that is the consumer aspect. The clinicians. Clinicians have to be involved in knowing about the clinical outcome, the mortality reviews, the morbidity reviews, ensuring that there is a clinical audit of all the patients, specifically those with a bad outcome, those with an increased morbidity. So ultimately, increasing the morbidity or increased mortality will definitely have an impact on the finances of an organization, because there will be a lot of cost which is actually not seen, but it is already there, it is inbuilt. And by involving the clinicians in these audits, the organizations or the managers will be able to save a lot of money through changes in certain cost center items, changes in certain processes wherein you can minimize the cost. And publication of the clinical outcomes. There are few hospitals still which are quite open to publicizing their clinical outcomes. One of the reasons why not many organizations are still publishing their clinical outcomes is because of this reason, that we perceive that the Indian public is quite litigatory and they might pick up the data and go to the court and unnecessarily create issues. But if all organizations are made to either mandatorily submit the clinical outcomes or at least start with a voluntary publication of the outcomes, it will really be very helpful to find out how they are performing and what changes are needed. Maybe the schemes like Ayushman Bharat would have that kind of mechanism wherein the clinical outcomes. I have yet not read about that. Still, it is all about covering maximum people. Clinical outcomes or measurement of clinical outcomes still is a completely a neglected or ignored subject in the big schemes like Ayushman Bharat or CGHS or ECHS. They don't look at the clinical outcomes. They are concerned about what people say is 70% of the disease burden, which is mostly the tropical diseases or the surgeries. But measuring clinical outcome is very important. It is a drain on the healthcare organization's finances if there are multiple problems. So it has to be measured, and there has to be a benchmark. So the organizations can be compared by looking at those benchmarks, and some mechanism evolved wherein the number of patients being referred to that organization are linked with the clinical outcomes. That will definitely serve a big purpose. Then coming to the managers. Manager's role is to ensure that the quality programs are properly defined. Okay? That includes the clinical quality and the administrative quality. All the indicators are properly defined, they're properly collected, and what most organizations do is they collect the data, they show it to their quality committees, but no improvements are suggested. They are just doing a mechanical job by just collecting the data, showing it to the quality improvement committees, but they do not look at changing certain processes so that those can be improved. We have accepted that if SSI is say 5 per 1,000, we continue to accept that months over without really looking at how we can change it or how we can improve that. So it's important that whatever quality indicators are measured are benchmarked against some of the best institutes or best healthcare organizations, and actions taken to ensure that those benchmarks are met by almost all organizations. There should be goal setting by the healthcare organizations wherein either the government or healthcare organization body itself comes out with the benchmark, and people should be encouraged, the healthcare organization should be encouraged to meet those benchmarks. We have already accreditation body which is in place since almost now 12-13 years, but still it is just collection of the data, and the improvement aspect is still not being given that much importance. So NABH should be bringing out those criteria or those benchmarks where an individual organization can compare their own indicators based on the type of organization. It may not be same for a 500 bed hospital and a 100 bed hospital, or the type of specialty. So specialty wise indicators and the benchmark of those indicators should be publicized so that the healthcare organizations can achieve that goal, and you can measure that. So that is the quality improvement programs that have to be defined. Patient safety criteria, specifically the patient falls, infection control, all these have to be a part of the quality improvement programs. Manuals of clinical processes and clinical protocols, all this should be well delineated so that the organizations are clear what they are talking about. So this is what I think all three have to join together and ensure that their goal is the same. Then only we can, so nowhere in this you can see that it is linked with finances. Indirectly everything is linked with finances, but if this is your goal, this is the goal of the organization, I'm sure finances will take its own course. It should not be a problem to achieve your top lines and bottom lines. If you keep this as the center point of the healthcare organization's goals. So it's very important whenever we are discussing about, whenever a healthcare organization is discussing about the budgets, we should also ensure that the clinical outcomes or the clinicians are involved, and the benchmarks for that particular year, that particular financial year, are set by the clinicians along with the managers. And at the end of every quarter, you should look at where you are, what is the improvement in the clinical outcomes. This will require a lot of digitization, a lot of involvement of the IT, where I still see that when I talk with most of the healthcare managers, most of these softwares that what we call the HIS, they give a data related to finances only. Clinical outcomes are still not being monitored. So we need good softwares for the clinical outcome measurements. Most of these are still, they say that it is EMR, which is separate from HIS, but it is not a big deal. You just start at least monitoring what is the mortality and start questioning the clinicians why that mortality has happened. Specifically, if you find that the patient should not have died because of that particular illness, had we taken some certain had we made certain clinical processes stringent, or there were no negligences by the management in terms of like the nursing care or even the clinicians. So that aspect is still at a very nascent stage. We are still transforming from a individual healthcare organizations to a managed healthcare organizations. So when we already taken the initiatives of provision of healthcare services to masses, simultaneously, if we start looking at the clinical outcomes, it will be a great boon to the country. Otherwise, it will be completely missed, and that time lost, we will not be able to recover. These are the pillars of clinical governance. Openness, research and development, clinical effectiveness, clinical audit, as I said, risk management, and education and training. These are all the pillars. Staffing and staff management is very important because ultimately they are the healthcare delivery providers. Apart from these clinical pillars, the organizations also need a leadership. Now, when I talk about leadership, it is not only the managerial leadership that I am talking about, it's the clinical leadership. The consultants or the clinicians have to be a part of the leadership of that healthcare organization, which will ensure that on not only the finances or the financial aspects are looked at when they are evaluating or when they are auditing. They must look at the clinical aspects. And it cannot be seen as in silos. The program of clinical governance cannot be looked at in silos. It has to be a teamwork. The managers and the clinicians have to work hand in hand and ensure that everybody is aware about the goals of the organization. Accountability is very important. Ownership. We have to ensure that everybody owns, everybody understands what are the goals of that organization, why those goals are important, and how to achieve those goals, and a culture of openness for clinical governance to be effective. If the clinicians start informing about the problems, informing about the incidents, clinical incidents that have happened in the organization, then there can be a discussion and there can be a way out. There can be an improvement program specifically for that. But for any reason, if they do not inform the management or they inform the nurses not to inform the management, there can be a problem. So a culture of openness has to come out. Still the organizations are wary about coming out in open about the issues or the incidents that happen. People have to accept that there will be mistakes, there will be incidents. In any healthcare organization, there are problems. And if we discuss them, then we can come up with some solutions. If we don't discuss, I'm sure it will be buried under the carpet and we'll never be able to find, and we'll never be able to learn what to do in case of such a scenario happens again. So it is it's the leadership's responsibility to involve the clinicians in informing them that please, if there are any issues or incidents that are happening in terms of patient care, please discuss so that a solution or a process change or a re-engineering of the processes can be done and an improvement can happen. So this is where the leadership governing board's role will come, wherein they involve the clinicians and tell them that yes, we will definitely take actions to improve. Okay, it should not be finding out who did it. It should be why it happened. That is the question that we should all ask when incidents happen. These are some of the roles of what I said about the pillars. Leadership, they have to establish the vision of the healthcare organization. They have to persuade the people to share that vision and have some innovative solutions for constant problems that are occurring. There'll be, if you are working in a healthcare organization, I'm sure if you do this small exercise where you ask your managers to write down the top 10 problems, year on year, most of the problems, at least 70%, will be same. Okay, so actually we should spend some time sitting with the clinicians and find out some innovative ways in which we can improve on these aspects. Responsibility, respect, integrity, ability to interpret data. This is very important, where there is a lot of data coming day in and day out, but you should have that ability to interpret that data and take decisions. So enormous data is not the answer. Even if it is a small data, if you can interpret it well and can take corrective actions, it will definitely lead to a better outcome. Good and fair judgment, high standards, accountability, as I said, answerability and responsibility is of paramount importance. And that is where the culture will play a role. So the governing board has to be involved in developing a culture which is more of an open culture, and people can come and talk about their mistakes freely without being fearful of the actions that can be taken. Then only we'll be able to come out with some specific solutions to a lot of issues that are happening. No blame culture. This is very important. Don't start blaming a particular department or nurses, and people should not go on blaming each department that that particular department has not been working properly and hence these issues have been happening again and again. So all of them have to get together and find out why it happened rather than who did it. So that is what the mantra should be. Patient-centric culture. Okay, it is, we are, when you meet the staff, when you meet your stakeholders, you all have to understand that the patient is the most important person in this organization, and all the activities have to be around that. So if that patient-centric approach is taken up by the organizations, I'm sure all this will definitely follow. If the organization is focused on the chairman or governing board, I don't think we'll be able to improve upon. So it's a patient-centric approach that we all have to take. A desire to quality improvement. It's very important. If you start feeling that in spite of doing a lot of things, things are not improving, that will not help. So you have to have a desire, a passion for quality, a passion for improvement, and it has to go on. You can never be tired because you're dealing with a lot of people who are the caregivers. And on an average, almost when a patient gets admitted in an ICU, some 15 to 20 people are involved. So if everybody is, everybody understands that the goal is a better clinical outcome, I'm sure these things can be really improved on. Learning, education and reflection, I cannot undermine the importance of these things. And it's a continuous process. Learning cannot be a department. It has to be encouraged by everyone. Everyone should be involved in the learning aspects, including the governing board. Including the governing board. I've seen that a lot of the governing boards, specifically those which are which have non-clinical people on the board, they are not aware about various clinical aspects. They are not aware about the clinical outcomes. So you have to even train them. And they should not be only talking about the finances. They should all also be talking about the clinical outcomes. They should be also talking about the quality initiatives, the quality improvement processes. That is the language. If the governing board talks, I'm sure it will trickle down to the last person in the organization, and that will give the patient centricity. That is what is the most important aspect in any healthcare organization. Clinical effectiveness and research, right person doing the right thing, that is evidence-based practice. You cannot, gone are the days when the clinicians used to say that I have experience of 15 years and I know this is the way, this is the only way to do. So it's evidence-based medicine. We have to look at what everyone else is doing. There are a lot of, plenty of materials available and it keeps on changing, it's dynamic. So you have to constantly learn. We usually idolized in the olden days some clinicians that they were great. Now we realize that yes, they were all fixated to certain ideas. A lot of changes have taken place in the world after that, and newer things have come up. So we should not idolize anybody and ensure that it is evidence-based medicine that is being practiced across the organization. Right way, skills and competence. Right time, right place. You cannot do a surgery in a small setup where there is no proper airflow, no air changes. So these are all very important to ensure that a better clinical outcome comes. And this all will ensure a right result. Audit is very important. Nowadays we don't use the word audit because we have seen that in the financial parlance, audit is more of like somebody observing in a very negative way and finding out your mistakes. It should be more of monitoring. What is known as clinical audit should be termed as clinical monitoring, wherein you are constantly ensuring that the outcomes, the complications, adverse effects, the other aspects of indicator, the other indicators that we constantly monitor are properly documented and brought out in front of the concerned people, specifically first the clinicians. They have to understand what are the reasons, and then the governing board. And the aim, it is very important that the aim of the audit is not to punish anybody, not to bring out the faults of the organization, but to improve upon the processes. So by tweaking the processes, you will be able to really make difference, what we call as ensuring that the processes are idiot-proof. Okay? Most of us have heard this term foolproof. Most of you are not aware that the spelling of foolproof is not F-U-L-L-P-R-O-O-F, it is F-O-O-L, foolproof. Okay? So, like, switching on the lights is an idiot-proof process. Even an idiot with an IQ less than 70 cannot make a mistake. That you just put it down and the lights are going to be on. So such processes have to be designed and developed in healthcare settings so that minimal mistakes happen. And there are multiple processes involved where you will have to develop such processes. There will be a constant innovation like barcoding of the medicines to ensure that the medication errors are minimized right from bringing in the medicines or right from the inverting of the medicines to the delivery of the medicine. This is just one process. But this one process, if you can improve upon, it will be major improvement in terms of your clinical outcomes. And these should be shared. Whatever are the processes that are improved upon, you should share it with other organizations. And that way you'll be able to learn from some of the organizations how they are doing it. Education and training appraisals should be based on, again, improvement of the processes or the quality improvement processes they've undertaken and not on the mistakes that they have committed. So still again, I tell you, in the healthcare organization, the performance appraisal are still, they have not reached that stage wherein they are well structured or well organized, where the KPIs or the KRAs are well defined, because still it's an evolving science and there are a lot of positions, and the HR still is again in healthcare, still there are not specific medical related HR people who have been well trained. So the change has to start from there, where we get the best of the HR people. They understand the key result areas for that particular positions, and then they can define the key performance indicators for that particular position, and they are monitored on a regular basis. Then we'll be able to really do a proper appraisal and can promote those people who are actually involved in the quality improvement processes. Patient and public involvement. Public involvement, I don't know to what extent we can do it. We are still mature. We are still not mature like the Western countries, wherein patients take things in a very positive manner. If there is a medication error, most hospitals try not to inform the patient. Most clinicians try not to inform the patient and relatives unless they come to know. And still they try to give answers which are more of evasive in nature and avoid discussing with the patient. Again, because we are more litigatory in nature, as we go along, probably we will have more mature patients who will understand that mistakes can happen. They have to be a participant in that quality improvement process and help the organizations, overall help the clinical scenario in the country. These are some of the mechanisms wherein you can take the feedback. You can have patient participation groups. Satisfaction surveys can be conducted. And nowadays, a lot of feedback mechanisms have evolved, right, from using the smartphones to having call centers and taking feedbacks while the patient is already hospitalized to when the patients are discharged. So these are the ways in which you will be able to take the feedback and improve upon the areas. Using information and IT, I already informed you, it's very important that we develop proper programs which will help in getting this clinical outcome. A lot of programs are there for the financial aspect. A lot of programs are there for billing. But for the clinical outcome monitoring, we still have to get good softwares, and they have to be improved upon constantly. It's quite complicated also, because there are a lot of specialties and a lot of these outcomes are linked with the patient profile that comes to your setting. So that's important that we evolve such kinds of software which will help us in benchmarking clinical outcomes. Staffing and staff management, I already told you about the role of selecting the right people. Risk management includes infection control, reporting of incidents. People have to be open about reporting of incidents. They should not have any fear of telling that, yes, they committed a mistake. So that will happen only if that culture trickles down from the top to the bottom, that you will not be punished for a mistake. You may be punished for a negligence, or you may be punished for being ignorant about certain things. So if that culture is driven across the organization, I am sure you will be able to really bring in a quality improvement. So this is what the new structure is. The governing board is the overall driver of the organization, and the CEO, which looks after the financial aspects, and the medical executive committee, they are at the same level. So the medical executive committee does not report to the CEO. They report to the governing board. And that is how we can ensure that the clinical program are given importance in any setting. Most of the organizations still have governing board, and the CEO, and there are nowhere clinicians involved. So this is the structure which all organizations must accept. And yes, there'll be some issues. There'll always be the management or the CEO will be at loggerheads with the clinicians, because the medical executive committee will be asking for the best for a good clinical outcome, and CEO will have his own restrictions in terms of finances. But a balance can be achieved by ensuring that there is a proper dialogue. And this is usually the structure of the medical executive committee. There's a medical director, or what you call as the chief of medical staff. Medical staff consists of the clinicians who provide the care. That is called as medical staff. And the organization which takes care of the medical staff is the medical staff organization. So, they also have their own constitution by which they have to work. That is called as medical staff bylaws. So those bylaws have to be accepted by the governing board, and the executive committee should be empowered to take decisions for a better clinical governance. The medical director is usually in rotation. He can be a clinician. He is usually a clinician, but he may come from a non-clinical branch. There are other department directors in like each major department, major specialty of that particular healthcare organization. Suppose it's a cardiac-driven organization, the cardiology department director, cardiac surgery, anesthesiology, all of them constitute the committee. They meet regularly, they look at the clinical outcomes, and they define, based on the clinical outcomes, they define the clinical protocols and make necessary changes. Where the CEO is an invitee member, so he understands what is happening in terms of the clinical governance. These are the functions of the executive committee. They delineate clinical privileges, a word of clinical privileges and credentialing. Credentialing is where you find out what the clinician is educated on and whether he has actually been trained in that particular area. So that is credentialing. A laparoscopic surgeon needs to have a minimum training, minimum hours of training in laparoscopic surgeries. And that benchmark is decided by the medical executive committee. Now, based on that, the medical executive committee will give the credentialing, and clinical privileges are awarded based on the training that he has taken, whether he can do a particular kind of procedure, whether the common debate is whether a surgeon can he do a colonoscopy or not, or it has to be done by a gastroenterologist. All these are discussed in the medical executive committee, and a particular healthcare organization can take its own decisions. And there is a paucity of time, so I'll just rush through some of the slides. But they all are involved in quality improvement programs. They review the quality indicators. They review the functioning of various other committees. They review the clinical incidents that have happened. They establish clinical protocols, I said. And one important aspect is reviewing of utilization of resources. If there are OT hours available, whether those are being used or not. So that is where CEO will chip in and say that we may not need more OTs. You have to utilize your resources better. And that is where both of them meet, can have a dialogue and come out with the best solutions. Components of clinical governance, these are the various committees which will report to the executive committee. So these reports are tabled in the executive committee, they are discussed, and the CEO is made aware about the clinical outcomes so that he can take decisions. The clinical audit committee, infection control, CPR code blue, pharmacy and therapeutics, pharmacy and therapeutics committee is responsible for maintaining a formulary, a medical records review, Ethics Committee and IRB. These are some of the committees which report to the executive committee, medical executive committee, and not to the CEO. So that is where the structure is important. Patient engagement and participation is through feedbacks mostly. This is, I already informed you about the medical staff bylaws, roles and responsibilities, orientation. And they also determine about the accreditations and what data should be monitored. If there are issues related to monitoring of, say, surgical site infection, what is the best way to monitor them? for any successful implementation of clinical governance, these all are important, and any organization has to pay attention to these things. And this is not an exhaustive list. It's a very vast subject. You just, even if you start involving the clinicians in the management, I'm sure it will take the organization to a new level. And instead of talking about the top line and EBITDA, if you start talking about the clinical outcomes and morbidity and mortality, you will not have to look at the top line and EBITDA in the years to come. So we all have to change our mind. We have to start looking at the clinical outcomes through a proper clinical governance program, and then we'll be able to reach to the next level. That change, that requires a change in the mindset of the governing board. If they are really interested in making the organization a great organization, they have to start monitoring those things. Others will automatically follow. Your EBITDA will automatically come if you give importance to your clinical outcomes and clinical governance. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Gadvi. Actually, it's a very contentious issue where the hospitals being governed by financial norms and the vocabulary between the clinicians and the managers is usually coming from very different worlds, and how they interact with each other. And this this framework provides a mechanism where both of them can actually talk the same language, and that's a great learning for all of us. And I know there will be many, many contentious issues. The framework is too broad, but there will be nitty-gritties involved and nuances involved, and question answers. We have 10 minutes for question answers. Yes, sir.
Question and question. I'm Sharad, but I'm really very much eager to know that. See, we pray for God just because of we have a little love with Him, but because of a more fear. So what I'm trying to say that while auditing, if there is no fear of punishment, so how that the clinical governance will run on proper way? And one more thing, what I found ki in our country, I don't think so, the doctor has been punished yet, very few. So if there is no fear, how it will be run?
I think, see, the first question I would clearly answer again, that culture has to be developed in an healthcare organization wherein people are able to work without fear. If there is a fear, they are bound to make mistakes. If they are open about it, fears and failures should be celebrated. Okay, if you have that culture in the organization, it will grow automatically. With fear, you may be able to control them to a small extent. You may be able to do it. But most of the time, they will try to not to inform you, or they will try to keep it a secret, keep it confidential, and you will never be able to improve the processes. So if you are able to develop that culture wherein people are, they can come to the management without fear and tell that, yes, I made this, I committed this mistake. I did not administer this medicine, I forgot. If you can help them in improving that process through various means, through your own innovations in IT, there can be alarm set in the tabs that you are providing, that will take the organization to the next level. Otherwise, you will continuously be facing these issues happening again and again. So that fear, I don't believe we should encourage anybody to be fearful. We should encourage in the organization. They should come out, be open about it, tell that, yes, this is a mistake that they have committed. Negligence requires to be punished. Negligence is something which we cannot allow. Right? So there is a difference between a mistake and a negligence that the people who are monitoring should be able to find out whether it's a mistake or a negligence. That is the first aspect. Second, about doctors not being punished. To some extent, I will agree with you. But we do not have that framework. Where is the data that tells us that this is where the clinician went wrong? And whether it was a mistake, whether it was because of that particular patient's profile, or he did his best, but yet there were bad clinical outcomes. So unless we all are on the same board, unless there are benchmarks set, unless we become open to it, unless the patients start understanding that it is not the clinician who is important, it's the organization, it's the culture of the organization which provides ample opportunity of giving better clinical outcomes. Still, there are people who would go to a XYZ doctor, whether his clinical outcomes are good or not, just by word of mouth. So unless we develop that, that's at a bigger level, where the mindset has to change, wherein they would look at the clinical outcomes, they look at the website, look at what is the outcomes of that particular organization, and the organizations also have to be quite open about it, that they can write that these are their surgical site infection rates, these are their medication errors, and people take it in a very open environment. I think it's a long way to go, but then only we'll be able to really come out with a structure. And again, it is not a punishment. There have to be areas wherein they can improve, they can be asked to go again for some training, and that culture has to be brought in. Then probably we'll be able to improve the clinical outcomes. Yeah. I hope I have answered your question.
So thank you very much, Doctor, for the great presentation. Like, say, in manufacturing organizations, we have moved away from financial audit now to quality control. And the same thing which you are talking about.
True.
Perhaps the movement will not be there on account of creating fear, punishment.
True.
And already there are issues of medical litigation and the issues of privacy. Can you throw some light on the best organizations? And more we start talking of best practices which are happening in outcome in some of the hospitals where they are talking and what impact it had on the outcomes. Are there organizations of those kind which are publishing those
data? Like, there are organizations which are publishing their data, like the Gangaram Hospital in Delhi is publishing their data. They are putting it on website. And those organizations which practice a transparency, which are open to providing data, which publicize their outcomes, I'm sure they're still minuscule in number, but they're growing. And as we are open, as the organizations become more open to accepting criticisms for issues, we will be able to still get more organizations to comply with the provisions of the publication of the data. Government has to play a major role wherein they should come out with some legislation where these data is not utilized in any of the courts or any of the litigations. So if that can happen, I'm sure more organizations will come out. And best practices, there are many organizations which have best practices and a lot of learnings from these organizations. So still we have a lot to learn from the Western countries, but involvement of the IT will help in getting more best practices to your healthcare organization. And now with the accreditation coming in, a lot of institutions have already accepted best practices. These accreditation bodies also transfer some of the best practices through their publications, through their websites. And the assessors themselves inform whenever they are assessing a particular organization, they say that if you change your process to this kind of process, it will really help. So that way, those best practices can be developed across all the healthcare organizations. So it's still evolving. As I said, the governing board has to ensure that they look at the outcomes rather than the financial outcomes, clinical outcomes. And the staff has to accept that the best practices have to be taken into account whenever they are talking about the patients. So that is what I believe that is going to help the healthcare organizations.
Last three questions. After that, 10,000 rupees per question.
Okay. Thank you so much for that. thank you so much for that informative presentation. My name is Prachi Mehta. I just have a few comments. They're not so many questions. One point that you made was the whole point of evidence-based clinical decision-making. And I see this as a really good opportunity to leverage technology because the clinical evidence is changing by the day, and it's very difficult for a single doctor, okay, or even a single hospital to keep up with it. So you have, if you have a centralized mechanism to keep up with the research, to keep up with clinical best practices, and provide a tool to clinicians and providers, I think that would be a really good opportunity to leverage digital health.
True.
Yeah. The other point I wanted to make is that rather than reinventing the wheel, there are already well-established organizations in other countries. So two that come to mind, one is the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality, AHRQ, which is a body responsible in the US for ensuring healthcare quality and research. And then the other one is American Hospital Association. They also put out a number of tools and techniques to ensure quality. So I just wanted to kind of throw out those ideas.
So I agree to your first point. Second point, I think Indian system is different. We have to evolve our own benchmarks. We cannot be enamored by the US healthcare because they themselves say that that is not the best model. If a patient who is having UTI goes to the hospital and if he's given an appointment after 6 weeks, I don't think that's one of the best practices. So we cannot just emulate the West. We have to develop our own standards. We have to develop our own benchmarks, both in terms of clinical practices and clinical indicators. Specifically, like our genes are different. The standards set in Western countries may not be effective in India. So they're completely different. Which model is the best healthcare model? I have not yet found one of the any of these countries have the best healthcare model. But if you look at Canada, it's one of the better models than US. So US is definitely not a good healthcare model. They may be looking at a lot of indicators, but they are looking at too much of data, but they are forgetting the basic things. So we have to keep this in mind. We should not ape the West. We should not be following them blindly. We should evolve our own benchmarks. We should evolve our own systems. If you look at West, even in the US, the patients prefer Indian doctors. Why? Because there is definitely a different way that we handle the patients. So that has to be emphasized. We should not be, I disagree to that aspect of just taking standards from any Western country and implementing it in India. We have to develop our own standards. Yes, we may learn from them, but the standards have to be different for our own country.
Thank you so much. And
thanks.
On behalf of Ahmedabad, I once again thank Dr. Bharat Reddy for this discourse between the financial and the clinical care outcomes. It's a very important discourse, especially given 60% of our hospital beds are now owned by corporate hospitals. And many of the corporate hospital governing boards are not clinical oriented. Thank you so much. Thank you once again.
Thanks.
Thank you. We will have a 15-minute tea break and we can continue the conversation there. The questions there are free.
Last comment, I think it will be very easy if you have clinicians who are managers. That will solve most of your problems. Thank you.